In most residential electricity installations around the world, you'll find single-phase power delivery. In North America, they have something called split phase, but in the rest of the world, it's typically one phase. You'll find three-phase power distribution in commercial and industrial settings. One of the most common three-phase loads is a motor. A three-phase motor works in an identical but opposite way to a three-phase turbine. Just as a rotating magnetic field in a turbine induces current in three phases, those same three phases will then induce a rotating magnetic field in a motor, which then causes a rotor to turn and convert electrical power back into mechanical power. There are two different ways in which loads can be attached to the three-phase network. There's a star connection and there's a delta connection. We're going to start off with star because most residential installations around the world rely on a three-phase star connection at the destination of the power, which is typically a house or an apartment, for example. If you live in an apartment in any parts of the world where they're using voltages like 230 volts or 240 volts, then you would typically have a single phase at 230 volts delivered to your apartment and a neutral. So you would have two wires essentially coming in along with the earth ground, which is for safety. 230 volts is suitably high to run all of the major appliances that somebody might need to have in an apartment. Neighboring apartments will also have 230 volts, but they might not be getting the same phase as you. They might be getting phase B or phase C. From the perspective of the power company, we do need to make sure that the loads are balanced across the phases. If I were to take a voltmeter, set it to AC, and measure the voltage difference between any of the three phases and neutral, I would measure 230 volts RMS. If I were to measure the voltage between any of the three phases to ground, the earth ground, I mean, I would also measure 230 volts RMS. If I measure the difference between neutral and ground, I would hopefully get a very small number close to zero. But because the neutral does carry current, I can't rely on the neutral as being a good ground. This is called a star connected load because it has four wires going to it: phase A, phase B, phase C, and the neutral wire of the star. If the load is balanced, there won't be any current flowing back through the neutral. If the load is unbalanced, then current will flow through the neutral. This explains why in residential areas, you have to have neutrals because there's no guarantee that the loads are going to be perfectly balanced. Now, over a very large geographical area, well then yes, you can start counting on loads to be balanced and you can do away with the neutral wire when you're distributing power over very long distances. But once you start going down through substations and you get to a level where you can't guarantee that loads are going to be balanced, these neutral wires tend to be very important. Another name for the star connected load is the Y connected load because it kind of looks like the letter Y if you rotate it a little bit. Another configuration is the delta connection. So I showed three resistors in the previous view graph connected as a star. We can also connect them directly between the three phases. You'll notice in the delta configuration that we don't have a neutral wire at all. The turbine would still typically be earthed, and this might not, in all practical matters, be a turbine. It's probably the secondary of a transformer, which would be earthed at the neutral point of the star. The delta load, however, has no neutral wire at all. There are only three wires going to it. We would measure with a voltmeter approximately 400 volts RMS if I connect it between any two of the three phases. For example, if I measure the voltage between phase A and phase B with a voltmeter set to measure AC voltage, I would read something like 400 volts if I'm here in Singapore, where the phase to neutral voltage is nominally 230 volts. If you're in North America, where the phase to neutral voltage is typically 120 volts, then a delta connected load would see approximately 208 volts from one phase to the other. Now, there are advantages and disadvantages of connecting a load in either a delta or a star configuration. Let's talk about some of these advantages and disadvantages now. Let's look at an example and compare a star connected load to the same load connected in the delta configuration. Let's assume that we have a three-phase Y transformer delivering us 230 volts phase to neutral. So we'll imagine that we're somewhere in continental Europe or over here in Asia. If we also have a three-phase load modeled as three resistors, and we're going to assume here that they're balanced, which of these two connections is going to use more power? the Y connection or the delta connection. Keep in mind, this is exactly the same load. We're just going to wire it up in two different ways and then do a comparison. Let's call this voltage across one of the resistors the phase voltage. We're told here in the problem that the phase voltage is 230 volts RMS. That's the voltage between phase and neutral. The voltage over here in the delta configuration, though, is not the same because we don't have a neutral. This is the square root of 3 times the phase voltage. The voltages are all a little bit higher if you connect your load up in a delta configuration. We're going to calculate now the total power consumed by these three resistors. It's a very balanced situation, so the power consumed by three resistors is just going to be 3 times the amount of power consumed by one of these resistors. The power consumed by just one resistor is V squared over R. For the Y connected load, nearly 1.6 kilowatts will be delivered. How does this situation change if we connect the load up in the delta configuration? Again, it's a very symmetric situation because the voltage in RMS is the same no matter which of the two phases you're measuring between. If I take the square root of 3 and square it, I just wind up with 3. If you compare these two formulas, you can see that they differ by a factor of 3. For a load connected in the delta configuration, 3 times as much power is going to be consumed compared to the Y configuration. This is interesting, and it has a very useful application when it comes to starting motors. As I mentioned, one of the most common three-phase loads is a motor. Motors use a lot of power, and they work very well with a three-phase system because of the natural tendency of three phases to create a rotating magnetic field, which makes a very easy conversion of electrical to mechanical power. You can very easily find three-phase motors in industrial settings. We just learned that if you connect up three phases in the delta configuration, they're going to consume more power than they will in the Y configuration. For motors, when you first turn them on, there can be a sudden inrush of current because a motor is essentially a coil and it takes some time for it to get started, to spin up. And you don't want the motor to burn out when you first give it a surge of power when you turn it on. So what's often done is that a motor will use something called a star delta motor starter. What this is a sequence of switches that causes a motor to be initially connected in a Y configuration or a star configuration. Let the motor build up some spinning, let it build up some energy, and once it gets some inertia and it starts spinning, then disconnect it from the circuit and reconnect it in the delta configuration. Then it has more power and a higher voltage. You don't want to start it in that delta configuration because the voltage is so high that sudden inrush of current can damage the motor. This is actually a fairly common way to start motors. All you need is a sequence of switches. There are 6 different connections on a three-phase motor. Let's count up all the connections. Imagine that I have a motor connected in the star configuration. There's one of its 3 coils, there's another coil, and then there is its 3rd coil. There are 6 different places where I need to make a connection. Let's go ahead and connect this motor in the star configuration so that the motor that I have here modeled as a box will match the circuit diagram to the left. This is the U1 connection to the motor. Phase A is connected to U1. Phase B is connected over here to V1. Phase C is connected to W1. The other sides of these 3 coils, U2, V2, and W2, are connected to one another to form the star point. That's how we'll wire up this motor in order to get it started without burning the motor out. After the motor gets spinning, then let's give it a higher voltage by moving it over to the delta configuration. Typically, this is done with a sequence of switches. We break all of the connections from the motor with the power supply and then immediately switch it on in the delta configuration. We have the same motor, and now we want to wire it up so that it resembles the circuit diagram here on the left. Here's how the connection looks. Let's verify it. First, we have phase A going to U1. And then the other side of that coil, U2, is connected to yellow. Red is also connected to W2, and the other side of that coil is connected to W1. Blue is also connected to V2, and the other side of that coil is connected to V1. If we look at our delta, we can see a nice sequence of coils. They're in series with one another, and that's the hallmark of the delta configuration. These labels, U, V, and W, indicate the correct order of the phases. If you get the phases out of order, then the motor might spin in the wrong direction or not work properly. Let's now summarize the differences between star and delta-connected loads. First of all, star loads draw less current because they have a lower voltage from phase to neutral. Delta loads draw more current because each load sees higher voltage. Star loads consume less power because at a lower voltage, you have a smaller V squared over R. Delta loads, on the other hand, consume more power. Star loads can connect neutral. A neutral point in a star load is also quite commonly connected to the earth. Delta loads don't have a neutral at all. They will, however, still have an earth that's typically connected to the case for safety reasons. It's not shown here on the circuit, but earthing is, of course, very important in any sort of industrial electrical power installation. Finally, star loads see the phase-to-neutral voltage, and delta loads see the phase-to-phase voltage, which is, of course, a higher voltage. It's higher by a square root of 3. Let's now take a look at the voltage waveforms that I would see across each of these three load resistors for both star and delta. Here we're plotting voltage versus time, and voltage is exactly the voltage across the load resistor. The red curve is plotting this particular voltage, the yellow curve is plotting this voltage, and the blue curve is plotting this voltage. The star point is our ground or neutral point that lies in the center of this graph of voltage versus time. Our voltage from A to neutral is coming first, then comes the voltage from B to neutral, and then comes the voltage from C to neutral. That's the phase sequence. Let's make the same plot over here for our delta-connected load. In orange, I'm plotting this voltage. In green, I'll be plotting this voltage. And in purple, we're plotting this voltage. There are two things that I'd like you to notice about these graphs. First of all, with the delta-connected load, the amplitudes are obviously larger. They're larger by a factor of a square root of 3, as we calculated before. What I want you to notice is that the voltage waveforms for the delta-connected load are not in phase with the waveforms for the star-connected load. We see that in the plot on the left, the voltage from phase A to neutral crosses the origin. If you look at these waveforms over here for the delta-connected load, though, you see that there isn't any voltage that crosses the origin. The delta waveforms lie in a symmetric sort of way right in between the star waveforms. This has consequences for loads because it's necessary to remember that delta-connected loads and star-connected loads might not necessarily be in phase with one another. It also has consequences for transformers because certain parts of the power distribution network might be out of phase with another part of a power distribution network, depending on whether a star-connected transformer or a delta-connected transformer was used. In the next video, we'll look at star and delta-connected transformers in more detail. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.